Today we're talking about China, the greatest country in the world, according to every Chinese newspaper I could find. In 2013, they announced a One Belt, One Road initiative, which sounds less like a game-changing geopolitical development and more like a beatnik's shopping list. All I need is a belt and a road and I am good to go. In fact, in 2017, Beijing decided to swallow its pride and come up with a term that would be more palatable for the international populace, one that would be seen as a win-win. What you're telling me is you were having trouble getting the international community jazzed about a belt and a road? No! Don't worry though, boy did they come up with a great replacement. After putting their heads together and consulting the Central Compilation and Translation Bureau and the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, they came up with a replacement for One Belt, One Road. The Belt and Road Initiative. Wow, you know that cost them millions of dollars too. So today we're talking about a very specific facet of the Belt and Road Initiative that gets a little less attention than usual. Malaysia. Knowing a story about China building three trade routes to connect easier to Europe, you probably weren't expecting to hear me talk about a country that might only be famous for a disappearing airline. But...
MCA's newly launched Belt and Road 2.0 under the Belt and Road Initiative will help to further strengthen bilateral ties between Malaysia and China.
Alright, strengthening ties. Well, 2 minutes in and this story's over. China and Malaysia are best friends. No, gee, what did Trump and or someone else tweet? Well, before we go, here's Malaysia's newest prime minister talking about how great their buddy-buddy relationship with China is.
Foreign investment from China to buy property in Malaysia, develop whole sophisticated towns which are priced beyond the reach of Malaysians, and the chances are that this development will be for outsiders, including mainland Chinese, to come and live here. That is not foreign direct investment. And none of our people are employed as workers. None of our companies are used for designing and planning and supervising, etc. We gain nothing.
What? That doesn't sound like the win-win association that came with changing the name to the Belt and Road Initiative. He's not alone in this new anti-Chinese investment push. That was Mahathir Mohamad, Malaysia's newest and oldest leader, being inaugurated at 93 years young. He was actually prime minister from 1981 to 2003, but I guess he looked at a newspaper recently and said, "Wow, I have to see this with my own eyes." Man, he's old enough to reminisce about the good old days of being Bernie Sanders' age. He is really not a fan of Chinese investment in Malaysia either. So before we talk about what's going on, we need to get a little background, because I've never seen someone so angry about being given money before. So what is the Belt Road Initiative? You know how sometimes when people go on shopping sprees? Well, China went on a geopolitical shopping spree of between $4 and $8 trillion. I'll have a port here. Oh, what's that beautiful piece of land over here? And let's put a railroad through there. All of this in the name of creating shipping lanes between China, Europe, and Africa. So what's up with Malaysia? They're getting more investment than a social media company with no clear financial strategy.
Over the past several years, Malaysia secured $34 billion worth of Belt and Road infrastructure projects.
Wow, okay, that's a ton of money. And don't worry, it's not getting wasted.
China's biggest property developers are building what's been called a forest city in Malaysia. It will stretch over 4 man-made islands featuring high-speed sustainable transport and interconnected roof gardens and parks.
So that's a thing. And despite its $100 billion price tag, it's about as helpful to foreign trade as Trump's tariffs. China has a fleet of cargo ships worth of investment for Malaysia, though. With that $100 billion forest city, a $13 billion rail line, and that's just the beginning. We have a $3.5 billion robotic future city, whatever the hell that means, $14 billion in ports. I mean China, I think we need to talk. This might actually be the first helpful foreign intervention, because you're spending more in Malaysia than a finance bro celebrating his bachelor party. I mean, what is going on? Well, because countries don't give other countries money to be nice, clearly something else is going on here. First, we need to talk geography. Now, because the last time I was forced to find a country, I think Yugoslavia was still around, I got a map. For those of you listening in podcast form, sorry, but I hope you tried harder than everyone else did in 8th grade geography. Generally for ships going around this area, Singapore is the go-to port. And if you've seen Crazy Rich Asians, you'll know that's worked out pretty well for them. If they could instead make a Chinese-controlled port in Malaysia, the main port for that area, well, that would be amazing. Only problem?
In September 2016, China Power International Group came in to co-develop the Malacca Gateway project, along with KAJ Developments and Dirian Berhad.
Yeah, these ports are joint ventures with Malaysia still controlling the ports. So what to do? What to do? Well, you could let Malaysia control those ports, content with your ability to wipe them off the map with the push of a button, giving you de facto control over those ports. Or you could do the same thing you did recently in Sri Lanka.
China has paid a little over $1 billion to take a 70% stake in the Hambantota port on Sri Lanka's southern coast. Now, the facility, which was built with Chinese loans, has been running at a loss since its opening 6 years ago.
So briefly, where's Sri Lanka on the map? Well, gee, I can't imagine which big country they're trying to avoid doing business with by opening ports there. So India is not too pleased with these new developments, especially the 70% Chinese ownership. Which, I'm sure given the context of this, you can tell there is no suspicion of misdeeds in securing that level of equity. Stop me if this sounds familiar. Between 2005 and 2017, China loaned nearly $15 billion to Sri Lanka for projects like a railroad, a port expansions, and building new top-of-the-line cities on the coast, all in the name of trade. Now, Sri Lanka was really excited. I mean, foreign investment, not quite the level where you're getting your own robotic future city, but still pretty decent. It was all going along just great until the Director General at the Ministry of Rural Economy realized something, and like economists always do, ruined the party. In 2010, foreign debt was 36% of the GDP. By the end of 2013, it was about 65%, and is estimated to rise to 94% this year. And that was 2015. Doesn't take a statistics professor to realize that by 2017, things won't be great. That same representative said, debt installments and interest obligations already exceed government revenue. That means we have to borrow to square existing loans. Basically, yo dog, I heard you like debt, so I give you a loan on your loan so you can pay interest while paying interest. Unfortunately for Sri Lanka,
the country's infrastructure have plunged the country into a debt crisis. Sri Lanka owes most of its debt to China. Locals blame the weakened coalition government of Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe for this. It seems chaos follows China wherever it goes.
Man, it's great to finally report on a foreign story where everyone doesn't hate America. So in 2016, they got $1.5 billion from the International Monetary Fund and an attempt at equity swaps where Sri Lanka said, hey, we'll give you more control over some of our infrastructure projects that you're funding and give stakes in our Sri Lankan companies to Chinese ones in exchange for debt relief. To which China summarily said, we want our money, not your empty airport. So in 2016, with 95.4% of all government revenue going towards paying back its loans on unused infrastructure projects, what was Sri Lanka to do?
It's a deal that the Sri Lankan government hopes will pay off some of its multi-billion dollar debts to China. A controversial agreement has been signed to lease the port of Hambantota to a Chinese state-owned company. Sri Lanka has also launched a special industrial zone near the port to attract Chinese investment, sparking protests. Beijing helped foot the bill for construction of the redeveloped port in southern Sri Lanka. So Chinese investors are paying $1.2 billion for an 80% stake in Hambantota.
To put all this simply, what critics are saying is that China's loaning other countries a ton of money to do these infrastructure projects using Chinese labor, and then putting those countries so in debt that Chinese state-owned companies can go into those countries and buy back the infrastructure projects that China wants at huge discounts, while still leaving those countries in insurmountable debt. And if you're thinking, Wow, why don't we do that? Well, first, see a therapist. But second, look at pretty much any non-first world country after World War II, and you'll see the US, IMF, and World Bank being all too eager to loan out money. I used to make content for Africa Business Radio, and believe me, they have not forgotten about all the great infrastructure we helped build there. So back to Malaysia, because in an ultra-timely twist, on August 21st we saw, Malaysia cancelled China-funded projects, citing excessive cost and lack of need. Which, well, those are two pretty good reasons for stopping government projects. Hey guys, there's this expensive thing we don't need that will plunge your country in debt in China. Where do I sign? I only wish that our government had that kind of restraint. We've also recently seen Pakistan, Nepal, and Myanmar reject money. So remember, developing countries, say no to funds. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking this floating logo to the right of my head. Or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. And click that bell so that freedom will continue to ring. Remember to give me a thumbs up, and as always, thank you for watching.